Breathe with me. Good morning. Lovely to see you. I am the Reverend Denise Cawley. My pronouns are she and her. I am the interim minister here. I was away studying church and landscapes in Italy. Really, that's all true, but I got many messages that you didn't match in your first round for a new called minister, and I really share your sadness and spent the first couple days of my vacation and study leave being really sad and disappointed and kind of shocked, and maybe you shared that too. But I just want you to know I believe this is just a setback, but not an end. Ministry is really shifting, and church is really shifting in the world. And we're being taught in all of our seminars really different ways to think about ministry. And so I think that this is just a reflection of all those shifts in the world. And pandemic just sped all of that up. And so we absolutely hope that you will find a match in this next continued round of search that you're doing. And even if you don't, there will still be options, and the interim time might continue, and we're seeing that as really common that happens, especially post-pandemic. A lot of interims lasted longer and still are. And that's common also after a long ministry. And that may or may not be your fate. You may be totally lucky and find the best people, because I've also seen wonderful matches happen in continued search. So don't feel bad. There are so many things that go into a match. And a match is so important. You've heard that from the team, you know, and the people who are coming have to feel like this is going to be the right place for their gifts and talents, and the search team has to feel like the people that they're interviewing are the right match for you. So much goes into it. I know that there's a habit in all of us to think, oh, what's wrong with us? There's nothing wrong with you. It just wasn't the right combination yet. So hold that. And I've had a bunch of people ask me questions what did people ask you? Because all the candidates go and ask the regional staff, they ask all the past ministers things. Most of their questions to me were about the interim work that we've done, and they've all been super impressed with what we've been doing. And so I think you should feel awesome about that. If we didn't find a batch, the board would set new goals for the interim time with the interim transitions team, and I know there are thoughts on what those might be. And they would certainly build on things that have come up and things that are unfinished. Or you might get someone absolutely fabulous from continued search. And so I just want you to be nimble and open to new ideas and be curious. So at this time, I think that this is always a lesson. Everything's data for us, right? So I invite you to think about what you've learned at times of setback in your lives, you know? Did good sometimes come from surprising periods of liminality, of those in-between places? And what did times of wonder, like I wonder why, offer to you to be curious about? So now is a time for curiosity. It's also a time to hold up and love on our search team. Can I have the search team members who are in the room stand? I see some of them here. You know, it's like half the choir. Search is a really hard team. They have to hold all this confidentiality. They have all this pressure. They feel all the weight to try to get it right. And so please, you know, drop them chocolate or love notes or dinner, you know, by their door. But really, thank them, because they did a phenomenal job from the point of view that I can see, it looks like they've done everything well. So please, please thank them. And think how disappointing this is for them too. They thought they were getting their weekends and evenings back. You know, this affects so many systems in the congregation where we've been on pins and needles trying to plan your goodbye with me because you need to have a good goodbye as part of your closure here, and the interim team wants to do a like summary of all the things that we've learned and you guys have done together. And the worship team is kind of also trying to figure out the schedule, and there's so many moving parts with music and children and stories, and there's hundreds of things that go into all the planning. I was talking to someone yesterday, it was Christina Smith, who's on my fellowship team here, and she said, yeah, until I was on the fellowship team, I really only knew maybe 10% of a minister's job. Most of what you all see is maybe 10% of what we do. And so there's just so much that goes into all of this. So I think it's a time for us to be really gentle and loving with one another and really support that search team. So this all goes great with today's theme that we start for April, which is interdependence. We're doing this service. It's part of one of the themes in Article 2 of our new values that we're examining. We always had interdependence in the principles. There's a new sentence that's been added that's really interesting. And in teaching the Article 2 class that so many of you took, I thought it was one of the parts that solicited a lot of very interesting conversation. So the worship arts team worked with me and wanted to talk about how we create our theology together. And special thanks to Ellen Vinzani, who helped Mari Van Meener for filming and editing your views. So you're not going to hear that much from me today. You're going to hear from yourselves. And then the whole purpose of this year of kind of examining Article 2 is so that we could study it more. So you're going to hear some of those theological reflections that have come out in the study, and they've been making new RE lessons and songs and poems and art. So you're going to hear some of that today. And you're going to hear from one another, but it's all about interdependence, and that's exactly what a search process is. There's no one thing that went right or wrong. There's hundreds of little points and little views that come together, and that's exactly how we make our theology, and that's how we make our world here. So I offer you this journey today, and I'm delighted to see you all, so thank you for coming today.
Good morning. My name is Lois Phillips. I am not Mari Van Meter, but I am here in her place. My pronouns are she and her, and our chalice lighting words today are from Judith L. Quarles, A Community of Faith. When we get to it, would you please join me with the bolded words? At this hour, in small towns and big cities, in single rooms, and ornate sanctuaries, many of our sibling Unitarian Universalist congregations are also lighting a flaming chalice. As we light our chalice today, let us remember that we are part of a great community of faith. May this dancing flame inspire us to live our lives with the Unitarian Universalist ideals of love, justice, and truth. And as I light the chalice, would you please stand as you're willing or able and join in singing hymn number 7, The Leaf Unfurling. It's in the gray hymnal. And then please remain standing afterwards because we will be doing the covenant.
Thank you.
thank you. And please join me in reciting our covenant. We unite to strengthen the bonds of kinship among all persons, to promote human dignity, and to increase reverence for life's creating, sustaining, and transforming power through worship, study, and service. Please be seated.
We have another big class of new members to welcome. And today, Dan Yokas from the membership committee is gonna help me. He's gonna grab one of those microphones. And I'd like all the new members who are here to come up. We have quite a few who are not able to make it today, but you seem afraid. Marta, yeah. Donald Beck, Kevin Christensen, Mary Freemeyer, Iona, I'm not gonna attempt your last name. Marta and Nathan, Amanda Nichols, Barb Perry, Bailey Pierce, Lillian, and Colin Smith. Come on up across the front here. And Dan, could you pass them each a microphone to introduce themselves so we know who's who, and you know who you should ask out for coffee and to have dinner at your house?
Good morning. My name is Dan Yokas, and I'm a member of the membership committee. I'm filling in this morning for Tom McTavish, who chairs that committee, and I'm sure he extends a warm welcome to each of you. At this time, we're going to ask my pronouns are he and him. We're going to ask each new member to introduce themselves with their pronouns, and you'll get to know who they are.
Hi, I'm Donald Bach. My pronouns are he and him.
Barb Perry, she, her.
You got to bring that mic right up to your lips. Or...
Barb Perry, she and her.
Lillian Schnitzler, she, her.
Marta Schnee, she, her.
Nathan Jones, he, him. This is Elika Jones, she, her.
And I know some of our new members are joining us online and some just couldn't make it today, but again, 11, and I think we had 13 last time, so what a joy. So new members, I hope, did we tell them to bring their, I didn't tell you to bring your orders of service, but I think we have a slide, right, Luis? We do. Luis has a slide up for you. So new members, if you could turn and face this, and you will now pledge a new member covenant to the congregation. So we'll help you start off. Dan and I will say it with you. We enter this faith with hope and possibility in our hearts, pledging to participate in and to support the ministries of this church. We covenant to remain true to the spirit of love that flows through this church and guides us. We seek your welcome as we join you in this faith. Yay. Congregation, all together now, we welcome you as once we were welcomed ourselves. We seek to be open and inclusive, respecting your inherent dignity, your ideas, and your vision in times when it is easy and in times when it is difficult. We seek to be supportive, not only when you reach out, encourage to us, but also when you need to reach out and to you. Yay! We have some gifts and things that Dan and I are going to pass out to you. And Dan, as you get started on that, you going to say something more? Were you saying something more?
No.
Oh, okay. And as we start that, one of the things we've heard from some of the new members is, in the past, has been, I'd love for people to ask me how I found the church or where I'm coming from or what I'm interested in. And new members, I want to say to you, always look for a balance. You know, people will pounce on you and be like, do you want to join our committee? And they're really excited about you. And always look for a balance. You need to constantly be filling your dreams and your soul and your intellect here, and it's a balance, as well as ways that you give to the church, whether it's a committee or a council or something like that. These are the ways the church becomes yours. You know, if you only sit in the seats, it might be your resting place, and I did that for years. But it's when you sometimes come to the movie night, go to game night, take one of the classes, do all those different things, attend the picnic, get to know more people, that's when it really becomes home in your heart. And so I wish that for every one of you. And we are so glad to have you in this Unitarian Universalist community of families. So thank you. And don't forget, there's always pictures of the new menu members on that column so that you can remember who other people are. And we put those into our database so that you can look them up and find their pictures. So Dan's gonna pass out roses for each of you. And we are so excited to have you in this community. I'm really enjoying Elika. Yay, thank you all so much. Welcome, welcome, welcome. All right, you can return to your seats. Thank you, everyone.
And now that my daughter's made her way back to her seat, I'm going to call all the children forward. Good morning. My name is Marta K. Chenet. I use she and her pronouns, and I am the religious exploration manager here at Countryside Church. As the kids are coming forward, I wondered how many of our kids know how to wave. Elika, come on. Sola, did I see Sola? And who else did I see? Come on. Come on, Miles. Come on, Ev. You can come down too. Do our kids know how to wave? That's what I'm talking about. In case they didn't know what that meant, I thought maybe our congregation could show them as a whole. So I'm gonna ask the choir to get us started. It's baseball season, y'all. I'm excited. Okay, so we're gonna start on this end. We're gonna go all the way over, okay? Oh, I was gonna see if we could like go all the way over and then all the way back. And then you're gonna hear the word wave a couple of times in this story. And I would like for everyone to do that. All right, so let's see how this works. Improv, it's great. All right, ready? Keep going, keep it going, keep it going. And back, and back, and back. There you go, kids. See, that's how you wave. And today I'm going to sing, or excuse me, not sing, oh my goodness. I'm going to read a story called Change Sings. A children's anthem. I will not sing, but thank you. I can hear change humming in its loudest, proudest song. I don't fear change coming, and so I sing along. I scream with the skies of red and blue streamers. I dream with the cries of tried and true dreamers. I'm a chant that rises and rings. There is hope where my change sings. Though some don't understand it, those windmills of mysteries, I sing with all the planet and its hills of histories. I hum with 100 hearts, each of us lifting a hand. I use my strengths and my smarts, take a knee to make a stand. I'm bright as the light each day brings. There is love where my change sings. I show others tolerance, though it might take some courage. I don't make a taller fence, but fight to build a better bridge. I talk not only of distances, from where and how we came, I also walk our differences to show we are the same. I'm a movement that roars and springs. There's a wave where my change sings. Whoosh. All right. We have another one. We'll go back the next time. Change sings where? There, inside me, because I'm the change I want to see. As I grow, it grows like seeds. I am just what the world needs. I'm the voice where freedom rings. You're the love your bright heart brings. We are the wave starting to spring. Wave, we are the wave. And back again. I'm gonna get you guys up and moving somehow. We are the waves started to spring, for we are the change we sing. We're what the world is becoming, and we know it won't be long. We all hear the change strumming. Won't you sing along? And now we will sing our children off to their RE classes.
For our meditation today, I'm going to read, and Lois will ring our bowl. And I want you to think about the words that are in the way that the new value is written. The first part of the interdependence value will sound very similar to the principle that you are familiar with and have heard for years. The second component might be new to you, and I'm finding I really like it, and it's very expansive, that's me, but I really had to hear it a few times to consider it. And so this is your opportunity to meditate on these words. So you're going to hear it go through twice. So I'd like you to take a comfortable place for your feet. Kind of breathe. Loosen your hips, maybe. Let your tension fall out of your shoulders. Wiggle your fingers if you can. Take a nice breath that's comfortable to you. We honor the interdependent web of all existence with reverence for the great web of life and humility. And with humility, we acknowledge our place in it. We covenant to protect Earth and all beings from exploitation. We will create and nurture sustainable relationships of care and respect, mutuality, and justice. We will work to repair harm and damaged relationships. We honor the interdependent web of all existence with reverence for the great web of life, and with humility, we acknowledge our place in it. We covenant to protect Earth and all beings from exploitation. We will create and nurture sustainable relationships of care and respect, mutuality, and justice. We will work to repair harm and damaged relationships. Cleanse yourself with a breath in and out. Shake any tension out of you. One more breath that you feel from your head to your chest, all the way down to your toes. Join us now for the first of our message videos.
My name is Ellen Vinzani, and my pronouns are she, her. When I think of what Countryside has taught me about interdependence, I think about the microcosm of our church community. It is the commitment of dozens of people who find and do their part that makes it work. Staff, RE, members of all the committees, and those running programs, David in the kitchen, Siri outside, and myriad more volunteers. I am awed by what we accomplish together. We depend on each other and grow in the knowledge that we are a small but mighty interdependent web.
Hi, my name's Jeff Phillips. Pronouns are he and him. And we're talking about independence, interdependence. Man, I can't think of a better example of interdependence than everything we do in choir and all in the music program here at CCUU. And it's just been, we can't do it alone. It's some, choir is something you have to do together with people. Even the ensemble work that we do with the band, it's something that has to all come together. It takes a collective effort. And it's just been so wonderful here with that. And out of it, I even got a wife.
Hi, I'm Robin LaBesse. My pronouns are she, her. When we came to Countryside back in 1997, we still had children of school age, and I would help out in the RE, especially with the younger child's RE classes, which was grade school level. One of our former congregants was very much involved in Native American spirituality. And she taught a unit to the fourth graders at the time about that. And I never knew much about Native American beliefs. And that opened my eyes to how we do live in an interdependent web. And the reverence that I began to understand that the Native Americans had for all things in life, all living creatures, really made an impact on me. And to this day, many years later, I still think about that. And I really appreciate CCUU for opening my eyes to with that experience. Thank you.
This is Susan Ald. Before I joined Countryside, before I even stepped foot into a church, my holy place was in nature. It was walking the beaches, walking through the woods, puttering around in my garden, looking for wildlife, feeding the birds. And I felt that I was connecting with something much bigger than myself. It was my spiritual place. When I came to Countryside and started learning about the interconnected web of all existence, and really saw and felt how I was connected to all those critters and all of the plants and the rocks and the sand and the water and the sky, my life expanded, and I became more tuned in to my natural world, which allowed me to become more mindful, and as a result, more poetic and interested in the notion of haiku as a spiritual and meditative practice. Of course, it also made me more aware of how I needed to be responsible in this world and connections in terms of keeping the balance and saving it. So I'm very thankful for the concept of interdependence with respect to relationships with others at the church, of course, community, as well as my connection to the natural world.
I'm a new member, but I knew when my husband and I joined that it wouldn't be just joining and we're a member. We had to commit, and we have to be, we're striving to be in the community and do things of service and work. There's some commitment there, and becoming joined with people in ways rather than just a piece of paper saying, oh, I'm a member now, and that's it.
Some of the ways that I honor the interdependent web of existence and have learned a lot of that work through my faith are through the community that I have found as a member of Countryside Church, Unitarian Universalist. It took me a while because of my own trauma as a person to allow myself to start forming relationships with this community, but once I did, something for me that has been transformational is actually looking forward to coming to church throughout the week, and then Sunday morning comes and I might get a little bit of complaining from my daughter about coming to church, but you know, nonetheless, we have conversations around the importance of coming here and why we connect to others and how important that is for our mind, body, and soul.
My name is Leslie Pete, and my pronouns are she and her. And actually, reading all these questions, I found I have pretty much one answer to them. I'm an active member of the Green Sanctuary Committee, and I've been actually involved with environmental committees since the start of the first one in 1999. And that's how I really respond to all of these questions, and that's how being a Unitarian Universalist has helped me with doing this environmental work. And then there's the book circle, too, where we specialize in reading environmentally oriented books. So it's just been great to be a member of this congregation and have such an active Green Sanctuary Committee.
As far back as I can remember, taking care of the world around me and environmental causes and concerns has been important to me as a person. So how I extend that with me is, for example, when I'm taking my dog on walks, I will often pick up trash. And when I see an opportunity to have conversations with people who don't really seem to understand the importance of caring for the earth, I will, in as gentle a way as possible, because I tend to be a strong personality, have a conversation with them about how we have a duty and an obligation to do that while we are here, of the many blessings that the earth provides us and things like that, really trying to help people understand why it's so important to care for the earth and not to exploit it, and conversations around consumerism and the cost of that and things like that. So that's why I'm grateful to be a Unitarian Universalist.
I protect Earth and all beings from exploitation in three ways. One is being in the leadership of Citizens for Conservation in Barrington, where we save and restore land locally. But nationally, I contribute to the Natural Resources Defense Council and Earth Justice and other national conservation organizations for a bigger impact. And then the smallest is having native plants in my own yard to support the pollinators and the birds and everybody.
Hi, my name is Gary Labetz. My pronouns are he and him. I've been a member here at Countryside for over 25 years and haven't regretted a day of it. I was raised Catholic, and I knew by the time I got to college that I wasn't Catholic anymore. And I didn't know what I was, because I didn't know there was a no religion category, if you will. And I had done some studying over the years and stumbled upon Unitarian Universalism, but hadn't really made an effort to approach it. But I knew that there were a lot of Unitarians throughout American history, and they had made an impact on society in general. When I came, I finally came to Countryside Church, and I immediately felt welcome. And after attending several Sunday services, the sermons resonated with me, and I realized that I had found a home, and I've been here ever since.
Hi, my name's Julie Ciccarelli, and my pronouns are she and her. And I've been a member of this church for 35 years, maybe. First of all, I think going to the church has really enriched my life, but the one that I value right now is the fact that we're all connected. I feel I'm connected to nature. I feel like I'm connected to other people. I just think I'm connected to everything, and that just gives me a feeling of security.
For years, I've worked with religious education, mostly sixth through eighth graders, both in religious education and the coming of age program, and just working with them to create a group and create a community. It crosses their social lines that normally from school, so it's just neat to teach them about other religions and in the environment, and have them learn together and work with the most remarkable children there are that reflect the most remarkable adults that go to this church.
Hi, I'm Mari Van Meter, and my pronouns are she, her. I think of life as this huge, beautiful ball of energy where everything's connected, us, the earth, the stars, and everything in between. It's like we're all part of a big family, sharing the same elements, from the stars in the sky to the dirt under our shoes. Now, our roots in Universalist and Unitarian beliefs really drive home this idea that we're all in it together and that we're intertwined with every living thing out there. Now, it's not just a nice thought. Science also backs it up, showing us how much we rely on Earth's ecosystems to keep us going. Now, feeling this deep connection to life itself makes me want to protect and cherish our planet. It's about taking what we've learned from those who came before us, and for me, expressly, my ancient Cherokee grandmother who helped to raise me, and from the world of science, and then doing our best to use it to do some good. Now, I acknowledge that we've had some not so great chapters in our history, but today, my family and I are doing what we can to make our world better, show respect, and take care of our shared home. So, in the spirit of humility and with a big dose of love for this planet, I'm trying to live in a way that's in harmony with nature and all of its creatures. I'm doing my best to make my mark by being kind to our Earth and to everyone on it.
Lots of good thoughts. The reading is going to be a theological reflection on the proposed revision to Article 2, Interdependence, by Reverend Dr. Sherry Prudhomme. We honor the interdependent web of all existence. With reverence for the great web of life and with humility, we acknowledge our place in it. I discussed earlier the Universalist's understanding of a common destiny for all life after death, thus shifting the focus of religious life to this world, here and now. Reverence follows this shift in focus. We nurture and rest our bodies not on a disposable planet, but on holy ground. We understand our bodies to be made up of the same stuff as the earth and the stars, and we cherish our bodies and the body of the earth. In our affirmation of the interdependent web of all existence, we can also trace the profound integration of science in our theological heritage. In both Unitarianism and Universalism, ideas most visibly proclaimed in the 19th century by the Transcendentalists were initially resisted, but then later embraced. They were influenced by critical interpretations of the Bible, the burgeoning fields of biology and other sciences, and by Eastern religions. Among their many contributions, the Transcendentalists asserted that we could know more about God and the nature of existence by turning to the awe-inspiring beauty of the natural world and the insights of science. They understood the non-human world to be more than inert matter and moved by mechanicalistic play of forces, but rather animated by a life force, a spark of the divine. One 19th century Universalist and Unitarian minister on the Pacific coast went so far as to preach that we humans had been invited as guests into the community of all life that was God's home. Many of the nature conservation movements of the late 19th century and the 20th century in the United States can trace their roots to this theological heritage. While we can be proud of these contributions, as love and reverence for the life systems of the earth are needed perhaps now more than ever, we can also be rightfully critical of the accompanying imperialism, colonialism, and white world making that caused great harm to indigenous peoples who had known these truths and tended these lands as home for hundreds of thousands of years. Many of our Universalist and Unitarian forebears viewed humans of European heritage, particularly Protestant Christian ones, as closer to God and thus at an apex of all life. We have since declared correctives to this arrogance, though we are still a long way from making effective reparations for all that was taken and lost. While acknowledging this tragedy and complexity, we have the Universalists and Unitarians of the 19th century to thank for solidifying the place of science as a foundational source of our theology. As science has helped us to understand the radically interconnected nature of all existence, as well as humankind's utter dependence on the health of the Earth's ecosystems, from the microscopic to the massive, for our very survival, our theology has evolved, and our understanding of humankind's place in it has become more right-sized. In addition, increasing religious plurality in our congregations has brought in perspectives and practices from earth-based religions of many kinds, amplifying an understanding of humankind as one part of a great interconnected web of all existence and deepening our humility and reverence for the web of life. This core value of interdependence in Unitarian Universalism, as informed by our unique theological heritage, has a vital role to play in a time when all humans of power and means in industrialized countries are needed to take action to curb global heating, to avert the worst scenarios of suffering and harm.
It seems to me the power for humans to think forward, plan their futures, and consider themselves first has caused us to sometimes forget where we came from, what we truly understand about ourselves, and the moment in time nature of our existence. It seems best to refresh ourselves of our lack of self-certainty as we move forward with an ability to manipulate our world, either for better or worse. I would like to strive to behave in a manner that fairly and justly recognizes my place in the world, operates with a healthy respect for what I've been given, including the power to mess things up, and conduct myself in a manner that is virtuously defensible to not only my peers on Earth, but theoretically, I suppose, defensible to some universal set of rules. I think the Article 2 amendment, specifically related to interrelatedness, works towards helping me live in the way that I would like to live. Rather than getting too caught up in the specific words, I do believe the intentionality behind the amendment is one of good perspective and is of necessary importance for any organization that professes to want to move toward healing our world.
Good morning. My name is Nancy Dempsey. My pronouns are she, her. I experience the interconnected web of life in terms of energy, rhythm, flow, and the breaking down of barriers between myself and others and the natural environment. As a musician, I have been trained in rhythm and flow my entire life. And what I find fascinating is the convergence of my different ways of knowing about the world on these same concepts. Let's start with the equation E equals mc squared. Basically, it means that the physical universe is not composed of solid matter, but rather of fields of energy. energy vibrates and therefore has rhythm and flow. I'm going to drop a couple of fancy terms, not because I completely understand them myself, but I've read enough about them to get their general implications. Quantum physics offers profound insights into the interconnected nature of this flow, especially with the concept of quantum entanglement. When entangled, particles become correlated in such a way that the state of one instantly influences the state of another, regardless of the distance separating them. They could be light years apart, but one is instantly affected by the other. Now, quantum gravity theorists envision motion, movement, flow as a more fundamental concept than space-time itself, emerging as the essence of reality, guiding the evolution of particles, fields, and ultimately the cosmos itself. For me, on an experiential level, by utilizing a simple progressive relaxation exercise, I experience cool waves of subtle energies that make me feel peaceful and energized at the same time. When these energies are strong and sustained over time, I feel that the barriers between myself and others and the natural environment begin to dissolve. Ultimately, I try to live my life as spiritual practice, seeking to put positive energy out into the web while receiving it as well. I believe there are sublime rhythms to the good, the beautiful, and the true, which I seek to embody with humility, because I can never assess the true impact of my most well-intentioned impulses as they ripple out into the cosmos.
Follow. My name is Debbie Lee again, and it's time for the offering. Giving is the ultimate way to ensure the true richness of spirit. Without giving, we water down, lost in the flood of our own self-focus. Sharing the wealth helps us live a richer and more meaningful life. And I want you to keep that in mind, because we are going into the budget meeting after church today. We have quite a shortfall. So think about the things that are important to you, be you here or at home, and what that value is, and where you can put your time, your effort, and perhaps some funding as we need it. The offering will now be gratefully received. Thank you.
And now please join me and all together stand if you are willing and able and let us sing together hymn number 37, God Who Fills the Universe. And I invite you, if the word God is uncomfortable for you, you can use source or light or love. Sing what works for you, but please join us. Hymn number 37.
Quick, after the postlude, if you have time to stay, the auction committee has a couple of guest announcements. They won't take long, but they're really exciting, and they'll get you ready to go on the auction site that starts today, opening, and you can bid and all that exciting stuff, and there'll be great guests for you to talk to, and I know some information you don't have, and I'll have a really quick personal announcement too. Right before that starts. So if you have time, stay, but don't worry, coffee hour is starting and it won't take long. Okay? In the name of all that is holy, may the connections between us inspire and sustain us. May that flame of life within us and amongst us shine and warm us. Let it be a sacred reminder that we are called to serve, to grow and to love as we continue this journey of transformation. Amen.
Right.